bet $100 we'd never win a game.
Lincoln.
Glasgow beat us that one year. We had a good.
The losing streak was broken with a tie against Lincoln. Yeah.
I remember the tie. That was 20-20, but I.
Locked on him, buddy.
You just come here for the food, didn't you?
Then he says Glasgow scored last game.
Yeah, did you hear what? Yeah, did you hear what? Team and 48 minutes of B team on Tuesday, and then 48 minutes of A team on Friday.
Yeah,
we got a lot of.
I love B team. You could have your way with them guys, you know, because we were quite a bit better.
Actually, our fresh pool.
This is why I moved over.
I'm getting my best sign. Man, got a wide angle win.
Did you punt work, Kenny?
Yeah. Rick did, not Kenny.
Kenny's still alive?
Well, no, I'm not sure.
No, I think he passed too.
Really?
Wasn't he in the Air Force?
Yeah, I know Rick did. It was about 6 months after our 20th reunion. He came back for that.
We won a game against the boys about that score.
They were
down here.
We
got you 6-3 when you were senior.
So that part's a lot.
Jersey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
I'll tell you what, his boys play football.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, guys are here to hopefully just have some fun and relaxation today. Let's try not to have any language. I have to try to edit out. But other than that, everything's fair game. But, are we ready to roll, Mr. Lomberger? Let me introduce our cameraman, Charles Lomberger. He's born and raised a Lindsberg Leopard, but we accept him anyway. Ooh, he's contributed some good kids to the school.
Oh, that ain't good.
Lindsberg wasn't good at all.
Lincoln Leopard.
Lincoln.
Yeah.
Lindsberg. I'm sorry. Lincoln Leopard.
Yeah.
No. Anyway, so we're ready to roll. Folks, welcome to a special occasion here. Dale Leach, representing the Minneapolis linebackers for this special presentation on our local Channel 37. Over the past several years, the linebackers have tried to do several things throughout to try to let the local people remember and encourage the current student bodies to know a little bit of their heritage in the athletic venues. And we've done a lot in recognizing championship teams and state contenders in both volleyball and football. I think we started out recognizing the 1949 team that went 9-1. Their only loss was to Hayes that year. And we've did a recognition for the 1972 team that went 9-0 and lost out in the playoffs. That was the first winning team and since these guys were in school, basically. Then we've had, a few years ago, a football centennial celebration for the school, where we recognized everybody that came back, but we specifically recognized teams from Ada, Adelphus, and Minneapolis that were champions, or league champions, or undefeated, or were in the playoffs. Unfortunately, that left out a certain category of teams that were good that didn't quite fit those molds, and a couple of those teams are represented here today in the classes of, the teams that were seniors in 1962 and seniors in 1964. They had two very, very special seasons in the midst of a lot of darkness in Minneapolis athletics and sports. To kind of give you a little background, Minneapolis started out playing in the several variations of the Solomon Valley League against teams like Adelphus, Milton Vale, Glasgow, several others in the surrounding area, mostly smaller schools. In 1939, they began playing the NCKL, and several fans were quite happy because that kind of graduated up to the big boys playing Beloit regularly, Concordia, and Marysville, and they did pretty good for a few years, and then they kind of went downhill, and then Gerald Shoemaker's classes came along, and they started to pick up again, and in 1949. As I said, they went 9-0, won league for the first time, and a few years later they tied for league. And then it started kind of going downhill again, and we had about 6 years from, 56 through 61, where their most teams they, or most victories they had was three, and then they had 3 years from 59 through 61 where they didn't win a game, and that was a pretty depressing time in MHS football athletics. And then we had two spectacular years in 62 and 64, and we went through another period of darkness, I guess you could say, of no more than two wins in any season before we got into the 71, 72, 73 squads, where we started getting 500 or over 500 again. And one thing that's been rather inherent in small school athletics, not just Minneapolis, but you have cycles of ebbs and flows of talent. You have injuries that affect seasons one way or the other. Some teams are playing in more difficult leagues than others, so forth and so on. And I know that all that has contributed one way or another. We're not here to poo-paw anybody that's ever participated, laugh at them necessarily, but there's been some interesting stories, to say the least. But we want to recognize two squads that 1962, as I said, they coming off of three successive years of no wins. They had one tie during that time, 14-14 against Lincoln. And then, boom, 1962, they opened 5-0, just woke up all of Central Kansas. So, gosh, Minneapolis, who was that? And several of these guys were either sophomores on that squad or seniors. And then 2 years later, they went 5-4 before things started going downhill again. Guys, those of you here today, just kind of want to just take a second to introduce yourself, give your name, where you live, and you got a better half, and how many kids you have. Oh, Neil Kendall, too. Yes, come in, Neil. Pass that down to Neil. You can have a seat on the end. Start over here, Kurt.
My name is Curtis Law. I live here in Minneapolis, Kansas. I was center on the 1962 senior team.
Dick Gary, I live in Hutchinson, Kansas. I was a senior that year, played halfback.
Kenny Wilcox, I live in Minneapolis. I played halfback that year.
Terry Robbins, offensive and defensive tackle for all those years.
He lives in Minneapolis?
Minneapolis.
Gerald Shoemaker, I was an assistant coach for those years.
And I'm Rick Johnson from Assyria, and I was a fullback on that team and defense, I think, linebacker or defensive end some of the time.
I'm Terry Parks. I live in Minneapolis, and I'm the end on those three years.
I'm Neil Kendall. I live out here at Wells, still in the area. I played, when Kurt left, I took over the center and then linebacker position in 64 and 65.
Good. I'm glad everybody could make it today. Just want to basically kind of go over some things that happened and let you all maybe share some stories that you might remember. I've heard some very humorous ones at different times, but I guess one of the things that several Minneapolis athletes have had to battle over the years is they come out of maybe a non-winning tradition at times that you all probably had to face too. Many of you, like I say, were seniors in 62. Some of you were sophomores. You all played on the 1961 squad that went 08-1, and some of you played or were part of the teams that were on the 09 seasons. That's not exactly what you call a great tradition and a perspective builder to help attitude when you start to come out and think about trying to get something going on a positive note. What was it like being with those squads? What do you remember about just the perspective, what you saw happening with your upperclassmen, what you saw going on? Any memories of that?
What I remember most is we was playing 11-man football, and that one year we had 13 guys up.
Oh, my.
Remember that, Shoe?
No, I didn't realize we ever got that low.
We got that low one time.
Wow. Remember, eighth graders, we scrimmaged the high school.
Yeah.
Remember that scrimmage? That scrimmage we played up here at the old practice field at the, what is now the State Yard. And I was an eighth grader, and we played them 6-6 tie.
Yeah.
And I remember how mad their coach was. We were really pumped up, and we're playing probably as good as we could play. But I can't imagine now an eighth grade team playing a high school team heads up. But and I think that the coaches were watching our class as we were coming up, because we had a good seventh grade, eighth grade class. They probably thought there was some hope in us baby boomers.
Yeah, Coach Shoemaker was our football coach in junior high, head coach. And I don't know how many games we won when we were in junior high. It's too bad you don't have those statistics too, Dale. But, you know, we did win. We won a few games in junior high. And I remember that freshman year, our freshman year, class of 65, Minneapolis, if I'm correct, had the longest losing streak going in the state of Kansas, 3 years running. And we threw a victory party when we tied Lincoln at the end of the season. Broke the losing streak with a tie. And several of us, then freshmen, did get to play quite a bit of ball that season.
Yeah, we would play, and it was a lot of fun. We'd play 48 minutes of ball on Tuesday in B team as freshmen and sophomores, and we'd play 48 minutes of ball on Friday on the A team. Now the kids don't get that yell if they got big numbers. I remember the soap scrimmage, it just happened to be they had the A team line, the B team back, switched around. We just had enough, Rory had enough to have a soap scrimmage, and a couple guys got their collarbones broke, and so we couldn't scrimmage anymore that year.
Mm-hmm. Well, I remember playing, you know, as a sophomore and a junior on the losing teams and getting ground into the dirt all the time. Sure got old fast, so it was rewarding to play on a winning team my senior year. And I remember the fall before the season started, you know, going down to the field and kicking the ball. I remember Kenny being down there with his dad and practicing field goals and things like that with anticipation of having a good season. And it was rewarding to see that materialize. And, you know, I was just one of three seniors that year, and to see these sophomores, super sophomores that year, to come around and perform like they did. And we had some tough kids on that team. I mean, Springers, and Tom Scher was one of the toughest linebackers that I'd seen. Of course, Terry and Jerry Woody and Kenny and all these guys in here were just real tough kids. So when, you know, we go up against these bigger schools like we did, you know, in football, of course, in basketball, satisfied.
Yes, Minneapolis was a Class B as far as state classification, and about half the league, I think, was Class A, Lincoln and maybe Smith Center. Minneapolis were Class B, but there was, Marysville, Concordia all had over 400 students in their schools, and Minneapolis was under 200, so it was.
I think it was when I was a sophomore, and different amount of sophomores, we played Chapman.
Yeah,
I remember that
game at Chapman.
They had, I can't remember, there was, must have been 150 of them out for football. And we had.
They were all big, too.
I remember coming out of the dressing room, and it reminded me of one of them cartoons where people start coming out of a building and the building just collapses. I was looking for that building to collapse. I'd never seen so many people out for football.
I wanted to go home.
Yeah. Well, by the end of the game, we was too tired to even go home, I think.
I think they beat us 72-0.
They was playing their Z team, I think, when we got done.
Well, that Chapman game was 63-0.
I was never tired in all my life.
62-0.
Kenny Springer, I said, Kenny, them guys don't look that big. I think we can take them. And he said, that's just a running back. And when the big guys came out, it kind of changed their mind.
Well, you know, one thing I think is commendable, not only with some of the athletic talent that you all displayed, but just the numbers and size. I know last year here at Minneapolis we had 35, 36 kids out, and one or two seniors, and most of them were juniors, sophomores, so forth and so on. And we struggled through some pretty good schools, pretty good size, none of them is near as big as Concordia or Marysville in student population wise compared to what you all had, but still they monstrous lines, etc. And they struggled through a 2-7 season, but they did get their second overall school playoff win of the season in Class 2A. But I see in 62, you all had, according to the paper anyway, 32 boys out. Three were returning lettermen as seniors, two was juniors, and six of them as sophomores. And you're talking about, what was it in it? A line that's 170, 152, 142, 175, 220, 145, and 165 for ends. That's not a humongous line, and I don't know if that was surely wasn't normal for your competition you were playing against. Of course, then you had a 129-pound halfback. They must not have weighed him wet at that point, because I read another paper where he's 135 pounds, but...
that was probably
but he was very fast. yeah, and Dick Garrett Jr. How size-wise on a normal basis were you smaller than the rest of the squad you faced, or
I was probably one of the bigger guys in the league at that 220, 230.
Okay.
But I remember one time in practice, and you know how you have the two lines where you go heads up and they throw one guy the ball and the other one tackles him. Mm-hmm. I was on one side and he was 129 pounds on the other side, and they threw me the ball and everybody just laughed, you know. And he stuck me and picked me up and put me to the ground. And I still remember to this day how hard he hit me. And I thought, wow, I'll start blocking for this guy. He can really hit.
I have memories of him too. My tailbone's
hard running
from him. Got cracked by him. I was 120 pounds as a sophomore. And when Kurt's ankle went out in that Lindsberg game, and I had come in, these guys looked like they were 10 feet tall down there, man. You didn't like that ball and not get creamed.
One thing I liked about football is you got to play defense and offense, and I enjoy playing defense even more than offense because, you know, I guess you felt like you got to contribute from the standpoint of preventing points being scored against you as well as, you know, scoring points, and you got to contribute that way. But for some reason, I just wasn't very bright, I guess, because when I put that uniform on, I felt like I could take on anybody, so I still got brain damage from it.
One other thing that enters into, you know, I didn't get to go home before the ball games, the home games, because living in the country, and I'd go over to your place sophomore year, and remember what got you pumped up? What did we got pumped up watching? Superman.
Truth.
I thought it was Shoemaker kicking our butt.
Fear factor.
Speaking of Mr. Shoemaker, I remember at halftime you had to either go into the old ag building down there, and the restroom was between the buildings, and or you went in the school bus, and you might have 8 or 10 tackles at halftime, and Shoemaker would get you back there, me and old Walt Smith and a couple of the guys, you'd have to bleep the rest of this if I said what he really said, but we'd leave there like we were Superman, know it or not, but he would pump us up. He was quite a coach and quite an influence in all of our lives.
Yeah, that's for sure. Absolutely.
It took me a couple years getting out of high school before I realized he didn't walk on water.
To say nothing of the basketball heritage.
Yeah. Good.
Go ahead. The Smith Center game was a swim meet. I don't know if y'all remember that. I remember. It's funny how you remember things, but I remember the temperature of every game and the weather conditions. I mean, those things stick in your mind. But my little brother Chuck wanted me to remind Kerry Parks that he watched that game, and Kerry had a clean uniform throughout that game. And he can't understand how that happened. Because
we can
so
tell.
See, Mom didn't raise no fool.
Don't fall.
I can still remember Kenny getting up off the ground and spitting water at him. He got a mouthful of water when he went into some puddle to tackle somebody or something. Love to spit that water.
I can remember Tom Scherer tackled this guy, and they just, it was like a motorboat in a lake and just left a wake behind me. It was so wet. There must have been that much water on the field.
Our old Kenny Springer got up and his face mask looked. He just had them two bars, and his just packed in there. And he's mad. And I did it to him. I knocked him down. And he didn't know it. He got up mad. And I said, "He said, who did that? I'll kill him." I said, "That guy right there, Kenny. That's your man." And boy, he went after Mark. But they had them face masks. They just collapsed right into your face if they ever had any pressure on them.
Remember Rick playing when he got a job rope? Ski mask on, and
a lot of fun.
Junior year,
we were going to play anyway.
Yep.
Yeah.
Fighting, played middle linebacker. You know, we'd pull into the two backers, one guard. What was it, 5-man line? Mostly we played 6-3. Yeah. But then sometimes we'd pull back into a 4-4 or something like that. And he always, I had to call the play. See, and they make. He was like, "Oh, come on, let me get back. I want to be a linebacker. I want to be a linebacker." He didn't like to be stomped with the big guy in the front line. He wanted to have that leeway, you know, to hit the holes. So he was always getting after him. Yeah. Then the coach was always saying in the play that I had to, you know, whatever you call it. Yeah. Sound all my choice.
What kind of offense did you all run, do you remember?
Kenny probably be. He was our quarterback.
T,
for
just a T formation sometimes.
Yeah,
straight T. Wasn't very sophisticated.
Yeah.
But then we switched in our junior, senior year when we had change of coach, and I can't tell you, it was different. I just remember it was different.
I'm single wing, didn't I?
Yeah. You ran single wing?
Bruce Ball played quarterback.
Yeah, Bruce.
Oh, yeah. And you were quarterback my senior year.
Yeah, and then Dick was our quarterback. One used junior and senior.
Junior.
Yeah.
Bruce had great big hands.
Yeah.
Huge.
Yeah.
Remember old Chuck Shoemaker, he would have a long pass, they'd sit and carry it hard to run down the field and throw it to Chuck Shoemaker. He had glasses about that thick. He could throw it 80 yards, but he had no idea where it was going to go. He would race back and somebody tried to run under the thing.
Coming off of three straight losing seasons, you go down to Lindsberg and come out with a big win. What was the score? 14-0.
I wouldn't know that, but it's right here in front of me.
At Lindsberg, were you shocked, or did you expect to win?
It was past this team. It was a community thing.
Mm-hmm.
My dad bet Carrie's dad $100, which was a lot of money in the 60s, that we'd never win a game as a freshman. And we tied one. And I don't know if you ever pay. You can just pay me now, Gary.
Tied didn't count as a win.
No, but I mean the whole community just said, you know, there's a school and forget about football.
Yeah.
What any expectations?
No, and then we're 1-1, and it kind of turned around, and you know, then it became an excitement again in the community.
Yeah, and I would say change of coach was all the difference in the world. Yeah. Coach Garrett Wheaton came to town, and he was a winner, and he had. Soldier, Kansas, he'd had winning seasons. And his biggest thing was to instill in us that we could win, and by golly, we did. But he was our leader. And
he was a quiet confidence. I mean, he wasn't...
Yeah.
He wasn't a yeller or a screamer. He was a quiet confidence builder, you know. And then the chemistry between him and Shue, Coach Shoemaker,
yeah, it was.
Does you guys remember the Concordia deal where we had swore to secrecy and then they beat us 63-0 the year before, and that team was supposed to be one of the best teams ever played in Kansas. Had like four people made the NFL.
Which team
are
you talking
about? I think it was 63.
It was our junior year. Yeah. It was Coach Wheaton's second.
We got on the bus here and went up there all ready to play, and ran on the.
Before then. We were psyched. We wrote Beat Con on our helmets. Everything we did with Beat Con. I'll never forget that. That was just, you know, and we rode up there in uniform all the way to the field. We got there. They were playing the national anthem. And we got out on the field. They wondered if we was even going to show up.
Right.
And then we got out there. We had them 7-0 at halftime because we recovered a fumble. Kenny, did you get it? Or somebody ran it in?
I don't remember.
Somebody recovered a fumble and we got it in. And we were 7-0.
beat them for a half.
Yeah, tonight we beat Concordia for a half.
For a half, yeah, that's right.
But then they whipped us the second half.
Well, I got to talking with Crossins that hired some other Concordia players at that time, and he said second half, you know, they were scared of the first half, but we were cool. Mm-hmm. Robbins was bleeding, Springer was blood running out of them places, handling those guys. And we got second half, I mean, we just ran out of steam. They were shifting offensive team and defensive team on the field, and we came out there and played our hearts out the first half. And well, if you can play on adrenaline.
So they were playing two platoon.
Oh, yeah.
That was our junior year, mm-hmm. and off of that team, their team, lineman Keith Christensen,
sure. uh-huh.
that went on, started at KU and played pro ball
mm-hmm.
for
well,
the
we,
Saints.
For years, well, we had to play offense and defense.
Yeah,
they too.
A lot of them still do,
right.
Well, yeah. Especially now when they've got so few players. But yeah. So that's another thing I hadn't thought about. But against Marysville and Concordia, you probably did have to play two platoon teams. Yeah.
Just remembering that night, going down to our home field, lights were off, we warmed up, we did all of our opening stuff, and we got back on the bus, and it was just a sweaty, steamy mess on that bus, and we had to drive to Concordia. It was something. Coming down on the off of the West Hill, you remember, on the south side of the stadium, running down, beating our chests. And as I remember it, the band man had his baton up, ready to start the national anthem. Didn't start it till we came down and got on the field.
I think Coach was just trying to just change things enough, just rattle it up and fire us up, and maybe take the edge off those, because I think they had the Meats and Reeves, and that one guy got killed in Vietnam. They had
Householder.
They had an unbelievable team.
What do you remember about the coaching philosophy of that game?
No, I don't.
I remember Coach Dreyer came back from scouting him. He was quite an athlete. He's a shot putter at KU, but he come back and said, guys, he says, here's a scouting report. I see two things that they don't do very well. He says, they got the sloppiest huddle I've ever seen in my life. And when they pile on you about 11 tall, they get up really slow. He said, other than that, just go have a good time. And that's about all he could see they did wrong.
That 63, they beat you 33-7.
We just ran out of steam, you know.
You were up 7-0 at half. Yeah. Concordia, they beat your sophomore year, they beat you 32-6.
I didn't think it was that bad. I thought it was 21-7. I think that score
34.
Yeah, that's wrong.
A bunch of guys were hurt.
Well, I tell you,
it said it different in our yearbook.
Yeah,
I think it was 21-7.
It's been interesting gathering some of these stats, because you go to the yearbook, you see one thing, you go to the little Minneapolis paper rag that used to come out at the interview, you might see something there, and you go to one or two official newspapers, and it's different there. So you just kind of take your best stab at it. What's probably they go over the Minneapolis Messenger, and hopefully that's the correct thing. I know you still don't know today. I said when we played El Saline 2 weeks ago, the score was reported three times incorrectly on the slide of the journal. I go, how in the world did they get that wrong? But anyway, and then you 1961 again, or excuse me, 62 came off that nice win at Lindsberg and came home and met the Trojans of Beloit that probably hadn't beaten in a Coon's age, and I think it's their God-given right to beat Minneapolis in just about anything they do. But he knocked them off 13-12 that year.
Yeah, we beat a good team. And they thought they were going to whip us.
That was the team Sheriff White was on, wasn't it?
Yeah, Kenny White.
White was on that at Beloit?
Yeah, 300-pound guy. I mean,
I don't know how big he was, but I guarantee you when you hit him, you knew it.
Weslowski
was an animal.
Yeah.
Had one eye right in the middle of his forehead.
Cyclops.
A raw meat. And I was it.
Kerry was the raw meat, huh?
Knocked me out.
Do you remember that? We had a defense. I was thinking about when Neil said it before, that wasn't Meats, he was one of the running backs for Concordia.
Mm-hmm.
And we had one guy assigned to him just to hit him no matter if he had the ball or not. You remember that? We had
David Meats.
I had that was my assignment for about four plays. I bloodied my nose and
go to the side. He was only 165 pounds.
I know, the hard nosed guys.
They were like fire blow.
Of course, you got Kristen in front of him at 250.
Yeah.
The Beloit game probably did as much as any game that year to make the community believe.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
The first game could have been a fluke.
Right.
And maybe partially it was. But that second game, when we beat Beloit, because it was down here.
It was at Minneapolis.
We beat Beloit that year. Then we had everybody's attention.
Yeah, that's true.
And then things started to gel for around the community.
Isn't it funny how we're talking about these big guys at 240? You know, now they're like that in junior high.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't know you weighed that much.
Well, then I was 215, 220. See, but now we're talking about Keith Christian, All American, at 255.
Yeah, Terry weighed the most. And was the next I think I was next.
But I was a lot faster than you were.
Well, that's probably true. You probably still are, too.
And now we're playing regularly against kids that are 270, 290 pounds, and they're quality athletes. I mean, they're not just big blobs of blubber.
Well,
you know?
And all the kids now working out on weights basically year-round.
Sure.
I said before we got started, our weight training was throwing hay bales in the summer.
They had a barbell. They had a barbell underneath in the locker room down there, and it had 150 pounds of weight on it. And if you wanted to go kick it around, you could. But that was the weight program.
Yeah.
And some of the guys didn't go for basketball, but maybe lift weights before they went to pool hall.
Well, except for carrying weight.
If they had it down at Joe's, it'd work.
On our class, the 65 team, or 64 team that graduated in 65, if you look down those weights, with the exception of Terry, maybe one other one, we had a junior high kid this year that outweighed all of those, and he was the ball boy.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah, on my grandson,
all of our of our linemen.
My grandson's little Salvation Army team, they can take out 150. In fifth grade, they can take out 150 pounder and put in 160 pounder. Fourth and fifth grade.
That says something about our weights.
Yeah. Well, that's something I'd like to talk about a little. Is when we started playing football. We started playing football in grade school. And the first coach that I remember was Mr. Rogers.
Kenny Rogers.
And your dad either helped him one of those years or was the coach then.
He wasn't.
Sixth
grade
year.
He helped Kenny.
But we inherited old leather helmets is what we had to start with.
Mm-hmm. Playing in the gravel.
Yeah.
On the grade school.
Yeah, I remember Ralph McPhillan grinding me into the gravel there on the grade school playground, playing, you know, eighth grade, playing in high school.
Not to get sidelined too much, but Ralph McPhillan went on and was an all Big Eight player at K-State when K-State didn't have football and was quite a guy.
Yeah.
They moved to Belleville.
Yeah, of course, I remember Ralph that. Yeah. He remembers Ralph McPhillan.
If you got dressed fast enough, you could get a plastic helmet.
That's right.
That's why I was in a leather helmet.
Plastic helmet.
The newfangled plastic.
Yeah. Yeah. They had the big box that sit out there, and after you were dressed, you could get your helmet.
Yeah.
And then you go out to play on the box.
That. You know, on that same note, I remember going to a basketball game in the late 80s up here and looking for the class of 65 pictures. I couldn't find them, and I asked one of the teachers, where's the class of 65's pictures? Oh, we took them to the museum. After so many years, we moved them to the museum. I thought, well, down
one
there
of
the
reasons
dinosaurs.
Why is because when we were in the sixth grade, we didn't have face masks. Everybody.
Yeah. I always wondered what happened to you.
Explained a lot. <doesn't>
digressing a little bit, but class of 65, we were the first class to go through the new high school.
Mm-hmm.
All the way through freshman
years.
Through senior year.
Sophomores when we moved up there.
Yep. Yeah, my dad, we were sitting in seventh grade or eighth grade in the old building, and he came in there. He was a contractor here in town and came in there and said, "Son, I'm going to have to tear this building down to get you out of here." So he tore it down, and I got to go to high school.
I wondered how you got out of
there. See, guys.
Thanks a lot.
Is anybody, we're in the library shooting this. Have you, any of you guys ever been in a library before?
Yeah. We used to have study hall in the library at the high school.
Yeah.
Well, back to that, the great team of 62. Obviously, the next year we found out that we weren't able to do it because of the seniors, Dick and Kurt and
Tom.
Yeah. But that last game of the season, remember, guys, Glasgow, we'd won that game before we got up there. Remember, we were already celebrating a 7-2 season, and it was an afternoon game, I think, on Veterans Day.
Yep.
It was an afternoon ball game.
It was a night.
I've got it down as September, or November 6th, actually.
It was a night game, and it was colder than a wilder destination.
Well, yes, it was cold. Nasty. Sorry, but
okay. I trust you.
I remember the day when
I got hurt in my shoulder.
Play that. When did you get hurt in that game?
First quarter, second quarter.
But they whipped us.
And I couldn't find an article on that game in the papers. So I just must say that. We ain't going to say nothing.
Well, that's good.
So our 7-2 season ended up being 6-3.
Well, they were champions of their league that year.
We had won that game. Monday.
Yeah. Yep.
The Glasgow Bulldogs owned Minneapolis more than once. I mean, they went at least, here's 59 through 63. They didn't beat them.
But we should have never lost that game. We was overconfident on the way. We thought it was going to be a pushover.
We were 7-2 and ready to start basketball.
Yep.
And we went up there and
they weren't.
That's true.
They were still playing football.
I remember I cried and cried to the coaches. I want to catch a pass. And so the Glasgow game, I don't think it was that one. I think it was the year before. They said, okay, tackle eligible, Robbins. Just step across the goal line, and he'll throw the pass and hit you and catch it. So I bumped and stepped across the goal line. Kenny hit me right in the chest with the ball, and it dropped on the ground. My glory. One time.
You didn't ever ask again.
He never offered anymore.
Well, it was his fault.
Didn't have the right ball. Spinning right, should have been spinning left. But he never got too mad at me because he's running behind the lines sometimes on that side.
Yeah. Many times.
I picked off a pass one time down here in the field, and I got about five steps before I got creamed. Of course, I lost the ball. I think Robbins recovered it, thank goodness. But, you know, you think, wow, I got one time. You throw my hands on the ball and take it off with it.
It's not that easy.
Yeah.
Gone.
Well, you always had your hands on the ball.
Well, yeah, I
mean,
didn't
let you keep it.
He is the only one who can remember the snap count, so they let him miss it. Now, defense, I don't remember any of these stunts and all these. We just, who's got the ball, get him, you know.
The only thing we had was rip and loop. We would go right or left.
Yeah, in the gap.
Maybe that was senior year. Right or left stunt. We stunted. Everybody stunted right, or everybody stunted left. Tried to hit the gap. That was basically it. We didn't pull any guards or anything.
I don't remember any sophistication on it. And the offense was, you know, heads up.
It was pretty straightforward.
Block and run and pass when it can. Whatever he carried, you know, if he didn't have his uniform dirty yet, might throw him a pass.
Only on clean field.
What were the a lot of the fields you remember? Were they pretty decent that you played on? We talked about the muddy field you played on once. It was pretty bad, but I know, of course, you go down to our baseball field today and see what's left of what used to be your home stadium. What were they like?
I was always impressed with the stadiums of Concordia and Marysville.
Yeah.
You know, that were built into the side of the hill and.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the fields were always pretty good, too.
I think the worst field we ever played on, and I can't remember, I think it was when we were freshmen or sophomore. We went up to play Delphus in just a practice game.
Oh, yeah.
And you talk about a bad field.
That's bad. I played there as a freshman.
Full of sandburrs.
Yes.
And I remember that, Dick. They used to plow it every year and then let it grow back to sandburrs.
We practiced on my freshman year. We practiced. That was the first year at consolidation, and we went there and played as freshmen. We practiced on that field a few times. We went to play our first game, and several of us came out, especially the linemen. We had tape around our fingers, you know, so forth. These guys, opponents, what's all that for? I said, you'll find out.
Trust me. Yeah.
But you'd roll over. You'd pick at sandburrs off.
Yeah,
it was horrible.
Probably the worst field we played on. As far as high school we played, I don't remember. Probably Solomon was probably had the worst field we played on.
Solomon or Lincoln?
Yeah, I was thinking.
Yeah, Lincoln wasn't too real good either.
Our field wasn't too good a shape after the Smith Center game.
Oh, well, no.
You know, he got tore up, got barren, you know, and then when it froze in the colder months, why?
Yeah.
Latter part of the season, it was pretty hard.
You know, you're young and.
Yeah,
you know,
it's football.
But it, yeah, it did. It did. Once you got out on the field, it didn't matter.
I remember hitting it, you know, with no grass on it.
Here I see our Otter County football teams, the younger kids get to play on the new turf at Salina tomorrow.
Yeah,
tonight
at 4 o'clock, the Salvation Army team is.
That nice new
they're
turf.
Running, like, you know, fourth grade, they're playing pads. And amazing little talents on them teams. Little down the sideline passes and stuff. There's some potential in about three grades right in there now, and fourth, fifth, and sixth. And I don't know how the seventh grade is, but
I do.
There's going to be some good football played in Minneapolis, Kansas in a few years. Nothing good kids now, but they're going to be big.
Be patient.
Yeah. Well,
not that there's anything wrong with what they're doing right now.
Yeah,
they're
exactly.
Just fine.
Yeah.
Well, they're doing good.
And reading some of the articles I've researched, seemed like there was some pretty good touchdowns that came off, I guess have to be described as the hook and ladder. Was that a pretty successful play for y'all?
The last touchdown that we ever scored in high school came off that play.
Okay.
Wally scored it.
Where you one in catches it and he turns
that
around
was me.
And
I
shuffles
gave it
off
to
him.
And then he, all the way back home, he rubbed my nose in the fact that he scored.
Nice, Steve. Nice pitch.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, nice pitch.
Yeah, that was my strong arm thing. I pitched about that far. We had to throw it 30 yards, and I had to throw it about like that. But I could see it went
to. I think the plays I like would be an opposite side end run, and all you had to do is the tackle was bump, and then you got to go across, and then you could block any way you want. In the old days, here comes some linebacker chasing and running back, and you'd have the angle on him, man. I mean, you could knock him in the fourth row. You could block low, and you could block hard, and was out in front of everybody, too. And they could, the only time you ever got to play and get out by yourself and do something.
But. Well, I don't know about you, but if I'd done that, I had to have the angle on him. I was pretty slow.
you know, he would be chasing the running back, and here you'd come after you bumped. And I think they have to block high now.
I was going to say, you could hit him low then.
Yeah, you can't block below the waist now.
Right. Oh, man, if you got caught blocking above the lace when we played, you'd get to go do some jumping jacks. Mm-hmm.
And tackle them. We used to tackle low, and now they teach you to tackle high.
We had to tackle low.
Yeah,
as small as
yeah.
we were.
That's
some
true.
Of the
yeah.
140 pounds, you don't have any choice.
Yeah. I remember playing Solomon, and I can't remember the kid's name, but I was playing defense, and he was one of the better runners. Maybe you remember what his name was then.
Solomon?
Yeah. Anyway, that was the only time I was ever knocked out in the game. I tackled that dude, and I had no idea that I tackled him. He must have fell over me, because when he hit me, I didn't know nothing until the next play. And that's the only time that I ever.
You've been dizzy, though, for years.
Well, I've been goofy for a long time. I was really goofy then.
I remember you got knocked kind of silly one time, and I made my way to the sidelines, and Shoemaker held up two fingers. He said, "How many fingers I have holding up?" I said, "What?" He said, "Get back in there." So I must have been the right answer. I don't know.
Well, he probably wasn't anybody left on the bench.
We only had 20-something guys.
He didn't want to play. So.
Yeah. Well, Dick, you had quite a reputation as a kick returner that time. You returned two for kickoff returns for touchdowns, I think, in one game, and had five overall in your career. Did they quit kicking off to you like they're doing now against our famous duo of Jared Schmidt and Kyle Lundberg?
Oh, I guess.
Did they do a lot of short kicking and stuff after a while?
Sometimes.
Yeah.
I know we had a play where we do the wedge, try to do a wedge, you know, I'd run through the wedge, and then we'd have a right side or left side.
You know, you enjoy blocking for a good running back that really put the effort in, you know.
Yeah.
If you got that hole open just for a few seconds. He was through it, scooting down the field.
I know, one of the best offensive plays we had was Bruce would, I don't remember what the name of it was, but Bruce would take the ball and he would, as soon as it was snapped, he'd just jump up and turn around backwards. He would fake the first halfback through. It was either Rick or Kenny, and then give to me on the second one. Terrell would be blocked for me. Well, they'd go for the first one, and then when I'd get it, why, they'd ball be aware, and then when I'd get through the line, why,
open field,
be
huh?
Pretty much over with, yeah. You know. Uh-huh.
I think Dick was probably, if he wasn't the fastest of any of the teams that year, he was second. I think there was maybe one guy that could outrun you. I can't remember.
I think it was me.
Yeah, I'm sure it was.
Oh, look at the lunch line.
I don't think there's anybody could outrun him in pants.
No.
No, I'm sure
they might have on the track, but they couldn't in pants. Yeah.
To avoid another game with injuries. Yeah. You got injured a few times, didn't you?
That, he had guy. Terry and I blocking for him, so yeah. He had to do something.
That'd be pretty good to get through there.
Coach Shoemaker always taught me, he says, whenever you get hit, get down, get right back up. You know, don't lay there. Get right back up. Don't let them know that you're hurting. You know, always remember that. Yeah.
They knew you was hurt, they'd just keep working on you.
I remember, guys, on kind of a serious note, and I don't want to turn this anything but really positive, but football was our lives, or a big part of it back then, and shooting pool and just a little bit of school mixed in there. But come back from Vietnam and went to a game, and it was a bunch of kids shoving each other around in the mud. And I didn't understand it. Before I went, it was like the violent, most violent thing I've ever did in my life. And I know Kurt, he's been there, done it, so. And you come back, and there's a bunch of kids out there, and it was a muddy night when I went to the game, and they were blocking and shoving, and I thought, that's stupid, why don't they just kill each other? And that was 20 years Scott played before I went back to another football game. Mm-hmm. But I enjoy it now. But it was just a complete, you know, something we thought was violent and tough, and you thought you were a tough guy. And all of a sudden you come back and it's a bunch of kids wallering around in the mud. But nothing to take away from what the guys are doing now, but there is a big difference.
Well, it's to go from organized violence here on the field to experiencing what you guys did in the horrors of the jungles of Vietnam, that definitely had to be quite a perspective change.
It just took a number of years to put everything back in perspective. So even though we're set here today, we'll have a good time, we'll talk about ball. I mean, it's a sport, and there's lots of other things that are as important or more important in your lives.
Well, I think you learn quite a bit from playing sports. I mean, teamwork and you know, sportsmanship and all that. I mean, I think it needs to be part of the
discipline.
School, yeah, part of the school curriculum, but I don't know, sometimes I think nowadays they've got too many sports, maybe, you know.
Well, that allows more kids to get involved.
True.
But it takes away from...
True, but it takes away from...
Certain sports.
Other sports, yeah. I mean.
I remember I was working heavy construction and as an electrician, I was driving home in my pickup from McPherson, and they announced, it's called Title IX, where the girls get to do athletics.
The early 70s, yeah.
I beat on the dash of a pickup. I thought that was so stupid. But how wrong can you be? Yeah. What a great program. Exactly. I mean, they're as good or better athletes now than the guys, and they're fun to watch, and they're competitive.
Yeah.
They have just as much right to experience that.
They didn't have a chance when we were going to school. They had two dribble basketball and throw it type stuff. And
yeah, I remember when I was in school in the late 60s, at that point, they were just letting girls come out the track, and they weren't real, it was just more almost intramural more than anything.
Yeah.
I mean, they didn't have official sanctioned track meets, but they did compete against
one of the
schools.
Best decisions ever made in athletics, I think, right there.
And then
I didn't think it was at the time.
Finally, they came out with some basketball and I think They started here in 74, maybe, something like that, and which we're going
to
be
those
celebrating that this year, too. But,
like at volleyball.
Oh,
soccer.
Volleyball, yeah.
Them girls, you see them, you just tell their athletes their shoulders are strong, and they're just, you know, great, great program.
Shoe's seen that with his granddaughters.
Yeah.
What would you be doing without those sports? I was strictly against it when it came out.
Because
they took one gym away from me, you know. But, I think it's great. I think it's fantastic.
I remember stories of living in Manhattan when back in the late 70s when they started having women's basketball there. And, of course, Jack Hartman was the men's coach. And I remember reading stories, Judy Akers, their head coach, was bussing because she'd have to try to go find the basketballs that Hartman was hiding from them and things like that.
Different attitude.
And then he ended up being women's coach there for a while late in his career. So things go full circle.
Yeah, the girls could be cheerleaders and you know. And
yeah, that was about the extent of their sports.
And I don't know.
They had the pep club. Which no longer exists. Because
all different.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know just the perspective thing again regarding winning and losing. I don't remember what – I know I watched all your games. I don't remember much about them. But I remember, of course, my older brother Keith was on those squads, and I remember him being all pumped about it and excitement. And then, of course, as years went on, I was getting into high school. Well, y'all need to be as good as we were, about you know, things like that. And I'm sure Chuck heard some of that too. Things of that nature. But you know, as it shows here, we didn't have real great seasons there for another 5 or 6 years. And I think my 3 years in high school, we won a total of 5 games. And even though we were undefeated in junior high, and there was probably a number of reasons for that, but there was a thing that was definitely there as a matter of perspective. We didn't have a winning tradition. You get in there and something didn't go right maybe in the first game or two, and you go, oh, there it goes again. You know, I know it was one thing our coaches always had to fight, was trying to get that winning attitude, and you talked about that with Coach Wheaton. He was able to get that in and help instill that into you. But it was just I know it was a battle on our part to suppress that attitude of, well, here we go again. But try to be able to expend your emotions and physical attributes the best to contribute to a winning cause. Again, you guys had to deal with that somewhat coming out of 3 straight winless seasons. Was that something that was hard for you to deal with? Do you remember that? Getting over that? How did you deal with it?
Coming out of winless seasons.
Yeah, well, I'm sure you had that perspective of how many animals had winning. And
will we ever win a game?
Yeah, will we ever win? And God, there comes Marysville and Concordia again. And gee.
Like they were saying, I think probably Coach Wheaton and Coach Shoemaker probably is the ones that pulled us out of that. I can remember, well, I played those 3 seasons of 4 winless seasons, pretty much, and it was a long drag, I'll tell you, ever doing that. And a lot of kids quit because of that, mm-hmm. because they weren't winning. That's why we had so few out, I think. But so, Coach Shoemaker and Coach Wheaton come that year.
Success breeds success, I think.
Oh, it does. Okay.
Well, it teaches you never to quit, not give up. Right. You know, mm-hmm. a few trips to Chapman can make you want to give up.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Those huge lopsided scores, Chapman, Concordia, Marysville, you know, overcoming that.
Well, why do you want to get beat up like
sure,
this?
Sure, yeah. Exactly.
You know, better things to do, like play pool at the pool hall, go down to Chapman and get. Yeah. But, you know, it was like a new start, having a new coach and then coach.
But I don't know about Dick, but I know by the time I got to be a senior, I wanted to flunk so I could play football again the next year. And it got pretty close.
You don't, no eligibility was up. Kurt, you'd already been there 7 years.
Oh, you would not take 7 years to get out of high school?
But some of us had played baseball in the summer and had some really good baseball teams, and that brought the winning attitude to the thing.
Right.
And I've coached guys, and I want to pick Chad Johnson example. He was a dedicated baseball player, excellent athlete. But when he would come to the event, then the coach would build confidence from that player's confidence. And then you'd instill it back there, and it would just grow. And there's something about the ability to win that you can't put your finger on. Some teams have it, and you know, and you the numbers don't add up to winning, but they win.
Right.
I don't know if anybody had ever pointed this out to you before or not, but when they said to spend two terms as a senior, they didn't mean Eisenhower's and Kennedy's. Oh. They meant like 2 years. when our freshman year, this 8-loss, 1-tie thing that we went through. Now, I know at his house and at his house and at my house, that was not acceptable from our parents' point of view, especially our dads. And I'm not sure about your dad, but or yours. But I know, especially at my house, that wasn't going to work.
Well, that's what that $100 bet was about.
Yeah, just try to collect.
That's plus interest now, buddy.
That's what scared me. Our main thing, and my main thing there, was what happened with Coach Wheaton and Coach Shoemaker. Yeah. But I was getting this side motivation, too.
But, you know, we got started when we were freshmen, because we were winning our freshman games.
Yeah. That helped us.
And then we were playing high school and getting beat, you know. But we were winning our freshman games, so that's when it was starting, you know.
But that helped us a lot.
It did.
Sure did.
And then, like you said, when Coach Wheaton and Shoemaker got us, well, that was the turnaround.
And they convinced us that it was possible, and then it happened a couple of times. Hey, these guys might be right, you know.
Yeah,
and it worked.
It worked. Yeah.
I don't think it was a weird, probably just an average or better team, but just coming off, you know, the 27 losses in a row or whatever they had.
You think you're going to win or you think you're going to lose. And we started realizing, you know, we can win, we're going to win. I remember our junior year was a real tough year. We went 2-7 after that 6-3 season.
Yeah.
And I, you know, after each game, we'd lost a close game. They were close games, and, man, that bus was quiet. It was like, oh. And we started to doubt ourselves again a little bit. But that was a tough year.
20-19, 13-12.
Yeah.
A couple of real close losses, 38-19. Smith Center must have been good that year, 33-0.
They remembered the year before.
Yeah, you beat Smith Center 20-6 in Minneapolis the year before. 27-7, you lost to Marysville. 33-7 to Concordia. And those are bad enough, but they're not like
53-60-0
like several years back. But, yeah, you had some decent games, and you didn't get outscored by that much that year, 208-141. That's not a complete disaster.
No. But the record was 2-7.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Concordia and Murrayville always had a good team.
Well, again, if you're playing small schools against two platoon teams that have good athletes on both sides, it's just hard.
And Chapman, they took two or three schools about our size and went together in a consolidation deal.
Yeah, they were for consolidation. Yeah. They were drawing players from
all farm boys, too.
Yeah. I remember they used to come clear up the 18 highway on Old 81 and 18 highway to pick up kids. I've seen their buses clear up there.
Well, they're still, their district and still is up to the 18 highway today. Yeah.
Look at all the great athletes that Shoemaker saw, though. You know, McCain and Chop Cooper and all. Zumwalt was the football coach.
Yeah.
Did you have winning seasons in those
years?
It
was a struggle.
It was a struggle.
But
all
we
the schools
could,
had
you
better
know,
athletes.
We pretty well dominated Lincoln.
Yeah.
And but at Conn and Bloyd, it was the same old deal.
Same
we were
deal.
Lucky to beat them.
Like I
say,
they always had
good
teams.
Always had good teams.
Was John Matt probably the best athlete you ever coached?
No, McCain was one of the best athletes ever to come out of this school.
Yeah.
What was his first
name?
Tom.
Jerry Baker probably before him.
I think some of Saunders' grandson maybe paid for UCLA later on.
Is that right?
Don came up to the Centennial. He's in Abilene. Was that his name, Don? Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So guys, not to underline this fact too much, but did anybody put the pencil to how many years ago it was we had that great season? I mean, it was only 45 years ago.
Russ, you hit. No wonder we're in the museum.
Whoa! Time flies, doesn't it?
Yeah, you're turning yellow here.
45 years, things were going on at that time with the Cuban Missile Crisis. Everybody wanted to get blown up, and of course, Gale Sayers, the Kansas Comet, was running all over the place in the Big Eight. Kind of perspective of the times.
Curtis McKintop is on the KU team. Fullback.
And Kansas City Chiefs even had a good football
team. Kansas City Chiefs were starting out. They had probably just transitioned from the Dallas Texans at that time, I think, or something like that. So
Kennedy was asked not what you can do, speech. So we go sign up. what were we thinking?
And Coach Shoemaker was giving us pop quizzes at the end of each week on current events.
Speaking of that,
I'll remember that, the Kennedy speech that stuck with the whole nation.
Speaking of that, so I could play. I mean, I wasn't the biggest dummy in the class, but I probably wasn't the brightest bulb in the string. But he would have Kerry take me down in the locker room and make sure I could pass the math test. And the coach of
that's the special tutoring, huh?
Yeah, you got to go down there and make sure you can.
One of the most difficult things I've ever done in my life.
Wheaton wouldn't let you play if you didn't pass.
Oh,
he wanted to make sure the biggest guy in school could at least play.
Wheaton had me convinced it was a package deal. He said that the two of you might play. I would properly motivate him and help him out.
Before we're done with this thing, I want to thank you, Dale, for putting this together. This is fantastic.
Absolutely.
If you did this, I mean, I was wishing I'd saved articles this morning thinking about that year, and here it is, so that's great.
You're welcome.
That's great.
Well, like I said, I just appreciate the opportunity to get together with you all, because it's all I heard about, as a kid, was, we were so good, right.
Kenny hasn't said much, guys, but
he was
absolutely key to this team. His quarterbacking ability.
Well, he holds several passing records today, and I was been confused because I kept hearing he played halfback, but
he had a sophomore year.
Okay,
but
and he
senior,
was our kicker.
Senior year.
What about our junior year, Kenny? Was
Bruce
still
playing quarterback?
Okay.
He threw the pass in the Lindsberg game to me. You know that really set the season off. That long pass.
Yeah, we kind of had a quarterback controversy.
Kenny was our kicker when the center could get it to him.
Yeah.
There have been a time or two this day.
We got you sober.
I don't know who the center was.
We got you sober.
Must have been Neil that time.
One way shot good at that point, were you?
Remember the Concordia game when we played Con down here on our field? And Christensen, they came out with five-man line. Christensen was head up over the center. He hit me so hard I ended up in Kenny's lap when I tried to hike the ball. He hit me before I could move the ball. I mean, he was that fast. And fortunately, I told Kenny to get the hell out of there because he's going to knock me back in. So the only thing I could do was take a step back and hit him low. And after I did that a time or two, they figured out, because evidently we were getting around him then and moving the ball down the field. Once it didn't kill me, he hit you. So I hit him low. Knocked him down, and then he had to go out and Robbins had to mess with the rest of the night.
thanks a lot, Neil.
But then that was the same game. They had Reeves, I think, was the back.
Yeah.
He's the back, and Coach Wheaton, just before we went out on the field, openly told him, no, it was the new coach, who was the senior coach.
DeVore.
He says, okay, Kendall, you watch him, and you go with him every place he goes. Well, he was tall, lanky. He wasn't hard to tackle. But that was the game, the guy that was the tackle a year before, but he was fullback, and he was fast. He also ran sprints, and he was running out of the backfield, and they had a play. The first half, he would run through the line. Well, I'd hit him, and about 8 yards later, we'd get him down. But the next half, they started running an interference man. He would hit me, and then he was in the end zone. That's why they really beat us that game. But I'll never forget being getting knocked.
had more confidence with Willie, Kenny, we all had nicknames, but as quarterback, he instilled a confidence in us that we really could feel coming out of that quarterback position. And Bruce did a fine job. We won a lot of games, but I felt better with Kenny as quarterback, and it's just like tonight, just or today, just sat there with quiet confidence and get her done.
Talking about teamwork, anyway, we were down playing Solomon, and I just started playing quarterback, and Johnson was tearing them up that night. And we just come back to the huddle, and my mind just went blank. I could not think of a play to call. And
which you totally called your own.
I sat there for a little bit, and pretty soon Terry just called the play, and we went up there and run it. Rick made 10 yards, and just like nothing happened, I come back next time, called the play, and got along fine.
Did I call my own number?
Yeah, you called it right over you and Sullivan.
That was the best play, Terry, following you through the
senior
line.
Senior.
Yeah, that was a game that you went around the end. You were running around the end, and you called. We were ahead. I just read it in here. We were a couple touchdowns ahead. And for some reason, I had in my mind, I wouldn't have let them score that night. They didn't score by Toby Johnson. But
whoops.
They Kenny ran a end play, and I was, you know, in the center out here blocking or doing something. Kenny fumbled the ball. And another guy, one of their backs picked it up and headed down the sideline. And something in my mind said he's not going to score. And I beat him. And he was a back now. And I was lying. And I caught him about a 15-yard line. It says in here, don't get it or whatever. But I caught him about a 15-yard line. Knocked the air out of me because I caught him. And then everybody, who was the guy that caught him? I said, Coach. And he pointed to me. And the coach looked at me like, you've been low time all the time.
Kenny did a good job at quarterback, at, especially like, I'm not sure everybody caught that, he did call his own plays.
Yeah.
And have somebody up in the booth with the...
Called your own plays.
With the radio back and forth, giving you all that help, and he had it. And
didn't even have a little alarm thing either, did he?
No, he didn't. We use those till this day. But
I just use them in my math class.
I'm not sure I can put that on tape. Did you ever hear the three rules? Deny. Yeah.
Too late to do anything about it now.
There were a lot of times our senior year that Coach Dvorak was the most surprised guy on the field because there were plays we ran that we didn't have. Mm-hmm. And we were in the huddle saying, well, I think this will be open. And he had to just be shaking his head on the sideline. Mm-hmm. He was winging it to spots we weren't supposed to do. Mm-hmm. And it worked.
Mm-hmm. So. Do you remember when you got near the end of the season your last year that Coach didn't have anybody sit beside him in front of the bus because he was going to call each one of us up there individually and counsel us on what we were going to do in our real lives. And I remember going up with my little plan and sat down with the coach and coming home some away game and, what are you going to do? You can tell him. He was the coach and the counselor, and now they got to have a PhD in counseling, I think, to do it. But that was what coaches did then. I suppose they do it now, but it was a... When you're 17 or 18, that's a pretty big deal to you.
Very big.
Mm-hmm. And I don't
coaches
know
were
what,
so important to us.
I don't know if anybody's plan worked, but
yeah.
He would want to know what you're going to do and if you're going to go on. And
did he say sign up for Vietnam?
I had a scholarship to Fort Hays State, but I was just tired of school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Kerry couldn't go with me.
I was going to say.
You lost your tutor.
Took part of me to commute. Yeah,
I said we're a package.
It's a package deal. Couldn't afford it.
No, I thought that was where the action would be, and it was.
Well, Rick, in 1963, we talked about, you went 2-7, but there was a bright spot against the Lincoln Leopards, 46-12, and you had a 243-yard rushing game, which is still pretty high on the charts.
That's a typo.
Could be because I don't remember that.
I
looked at that this morning when you gave these stats out, and I wondered if that was, is that how many yards I gained that year?
No, that's that game, supposedly, according to the reports.
I'll tell you.
You don't remember it, huh?
The only thing I can say about that was to get that many yards, the number was called over Robbins quite a bit because he was such a darn good blocker. there were always big holes.
That's when we had that cross pattern.
Yeah.
We saw them across.
Yeah. I'm just going to say that. We had the simplest play.
Afraid to do that hole.
Simplest play. We just see who's heads up on us.
Yeah.
And I'd say, Sully, cross, you go first. And he'd just take that angle, and I'd take this angle. And you think about 15 times, them guys will get wise to that, but they didn't seem to. And then you had that blocking angle on the people.
Anytime we needed 5 or 10 yards, it was just automatic. That was what you called. Because it was there.
That's the way it was when we were seniors.
Yep.
Same. Quarterback sneak. Yep.
You know, I was taught you that blocking pattern today. That's what I was taught. So you use that. Junior, I usually that same pattern today.
Just a real simple, depends where they basis. Got on you. Head.
I didn't have a man on me, and I could get the middle linebacker.
Yeah. Get another 10. But I don't know. It was like, don't let your buddies down type thing. It wasn't like just big sophisticated, we're going to do this for the team, the school, the community. It's like, hey, I don't want him to get tackled, so block somebody.
Well, you just went into a different mindset. When you put that helmet on, the whistle blew after the first play, the butterfly was gone, and then it was mm-hmm. just... Just,
particularly on defense.
I mean, it was just and you just turned into.
Didn't we live for Friday nights?
Oh. I mean, Friday night lights, huh?
You were scared, but you still were.
You know, yeah. So exciting, the game day, and
yeah, there were several weeks, and I run around on crutches all week at school on Friday night. I'd play football. Yeah. Remember that?
Yeah.
That's how you got out of those practices.
I did. My senior year, I hardly ever practiced. I wasn't very many. Somebody messed my ankle up in one practice right at the first of the year. Can't
surely he? Not.
He told me he didn't like it.
Evidently not.
I remember that soap scrimmage. I can't remember. It might have been our sophomore year. Well, like Terry was saying, they had the 18 backs and the B team line and the, just vice versa. And I don't know, I hit you coming around in one day and rolled both of us out there in the bleachers. And Dad told me the next morning, he said, I can't remember who he was standing beside, but he said, if they're going to hit each other that hard, they're going to win some ball games. And you know, that was just you know, it was just a mindset from then on, and, you know, we could win.
Yep.
And we did.
Wasn't it fun?
Yeah.
Didn't get off to a very good start that year, as I recall. So our senior year with
senior year.
You picked things
yeah,
up.
Yeah, you lost a couple there to open up.
Yeah.
Lindsberg and Beloit.
After that.
But then you reeled off some victories. And then lost to the old nemesis Marysville, Concordia, and then ended on a nice note of 13-6 and 33-6. And I think somewhere in that Glasgow game of 33-6, he had a real long play, 97 yards. I can't remember what it was now. Was that, am I thinking of something else, or was it a pass play?
Wasn't that an afternoon game?
Yep. Glasgow?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well,
was.
That was
that's
the afternoon
that was
game.
Yeah, that's
right.
What I think.
I don't,
yeah.
It was. I don't remember playing a day game when we were.
Glasgow was
so that must that was our senior year.
Our
senior year.
But it was
that was I was thinking that was the day we got beat.
Sun
got
my eyes.
It was a really nice day.
It was a nice day.
At that time of year.
I remember
that was the day Robbins tried to score and dropped the ball.
That sun was in my eyes.
Yeah.
Sure it was.
Look at these stats from 59 to 64. That's the only year that we beat Glasgow was our
mm-hmm.
senior year.
Mm-hmm.
Glasgow. Jeez.
You know.
But it's just coming back to me. In grade school, we played them in basketball. And they had a guy, his name was Brock, and he had a jump shot in grade school. And it was either fifth or sixth grade. They came to Minneapolis to play us in basketball.
Sixth.
We got beat 41-3.
Absolutely not. It was 41-0.
No, we got three free. We got
the year before
throws.
We got nothing. They shut us out 1 year
throws.
In basketball. The next year,
should've
we never
known.
Scored a field goal in a basketball game.
Yeah. In grade school. And then you start thinking, will we ever win a game?
And
this
I
didn't help confidence.
I would have continued to play with you guys in basketball if I just bought a jersey would have fit me.
Now you tell us.
Pat Nodding wasn't in business then.
You know, everybody wore the skin tight things back then. When they quit doing that.
You didn't like those little short shorts they wore?
3 years.
I played on that. 3 years. Team.
He saw the writing on the wall. Senior year.
Nice thing about Coach Shoemaker, you know, football, if you lost, you had the basketball season to look forward to because you go back and beat those same teams in basketball, so you get revenge, you know. So that was always nice.
It's like K-State years ago, huh?
Yeah.
By the way, some guy came up to me, it's only been a few months ago, and I can't remember who it was, and he said, do you remember the Solomon game, Robbins, when you got 3 face mask penalties in a row? And I do remember because the coach was screaming at me, but they'd run around the end. I couldn't quite catch them, and I just get their face mask and just stuff them. And they quit coming around there, though. But it was 45 yards of penalty, and the ref said, one more time, you're out of the game.
I'm surprised coach had benched him.
But we, it was a fun game.
That was a dirty play.
I wasn't dirty, just a good handle.
Not in them days.
No.
They put them handles on there for a reason.
Yeah.
But he took the other end next time. But we beat him like 30s or something. That was a real fun trip home. I remember.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why I wasn't allowed to go. He wouldn't school.
Who do you remember that's not here that was? I remember Wally was a hard runner.
Steve Wally?
Steve was a hard runner.
And what year did
didn't
he join?
Didn't
win
a whiner, nothing.
That was the year. I think
junior or senior year?
Was
senior
year?
Senior
he just
year.
Came over senior year, didn't he?
Senior year.
From Colville.
I think he was here or was junior?
Greg Sullivan.
Oh, Greg,
but
good. Yeah, you bet.
Do you remember him playing?
Daryl Adams, I can remember when we were seniors, and when I did practice, he held my blocking dummy. And I can remember not thinking then, this kid's tough. Because every time I played, I ran out there and knocked him on his butt. And he'd just get right back up. And you could see him. Every time I recall a play, he'd get that blocking dummy, he'd go like this. Because he knew he was going to lay him back there. Remember that?
Oh, yeah.
I thought, man, that kid's going to quit. I got to quit hitting him, but he'd just get right back up. And, yep.
Who is the blocking dummy here?
But yeah, he was tough. To stand that.
Yeah, Kenny was a pretty tough kid. And Ricky Springer.
Yeah,
that Abbott boy played good ball. I can't remember his name.
Yeah,
Danny Abbott.
Yeah,
he's a linebacker.
He's a good linebacker.
Had attitude.
Good.
Sorry,
I thought.
Dinner ready?
Yeah.
Dinner time.
Let's call you back, George. Okay. I was going to put that on vibrate, and I forgot.
Remember, Bud Dewey came out. We couldn't get no clothes to fit him, so he never did wear shoulder or hip pads or nothing. Just pants. He weighed about 320.
I remember we used to head on head block it, and you'd be on the 5 yard line, and you had to push the other one back 5 yards, one way or the other. And I got the block against Bud Dewey one time. He didn't do nothing. He just laid there and laughed at me. And I just worked and worked and worked. I couldn't move him. But he wouldn't move me. Not that he couldn't.
Tom Scher is a good player.
Tom was good.
Who played the other end, Kerry?
Which year?
Jerry Woody.
Woody. We were sophomore. And then Chuck came along.
Walt Smith. Oh, you talked about pep talks. I mentioned that earlier in the program, but me and Walt would get some pep talks from the coach.
What was the motivational words were used? That were clean.
I don't know any that you could say on film.
I heard
you know, you might have 10 tackles at halftime and you're a loser, you know. My guys. Guys would kill for 10 tackles. You guys are the biggest and dumbest. Inspirational.
What coach?
He would always get us. The real coach, you know, the head coach, would take you backs and go up and praise you, I'm sure. And he would take us linemen back there and tell us what we need to do to pick it up a little. In the back of that old 4-H building.
Linemen always got the worst thing.
Oh, yeah.
It was always their fault. Isn't that right, Dick?
It really was.
He probably took
We were small.
All I know is I always make the tackles because you linemen couldn't catch.
We told him.
And we didn't always make the tackles.
Yeah, we didn't always make
them out. Oh, mercy.
And you didn't always either. The only reason you had to make them because you could catch them from behind, most of them.
Yeah. I probably hated kickoffs the worst because, man, there's no protection there. If you're in the line, you know, you can kind of control the situation. But on a kickoff, blocking or trying to tackle the guy, I hated them. I just loafed. Let somebody else get them.
Let
them guys do that for a while. I'll be around later. Just call me if you need me.
I remember getting in touch with my stupidity. Concordia junior, whenever we played them at home at junior or senior year, I don't know. But I was receiving a punt just before the first half, just before halftime. And I had no awareness of how close I was to the end zone. And I caught the ball. And then I got tackled. I got creamed. About put my back out. And I should have just let the ball go into the end zone. But not smart. No points were scored, but I got hit.
Very deep.
That was one of those times that Robbins did not
walk. See,
there's
no advantage on a defensive kick return. I mean, there's a running back coming. He's faster than you, and he's quicker than you. And you're just probably going to look silly trying to tackle the guy, so just kind of let the other guys do it.
Oh, yeah.
Save yourself for the real game.
Well, guys, I really appreciate you coming, especially Dick from all the way from Hutchison and Rick from up from this area. Appreciate you all getting together. And so those of you youngsters that are out there listening to this, you see these aren't just old duffers. They had a contribution to the scene when they were in school. And too bad we don't have films from those days to go back and play on TV to inspire them. But
highlights would not be bad.
But these guys were very much a part of a inspirational time when, in the midst of a lot of darkness. 6 years before and 6 years after is a long time to have losing seasons. It really affects the psyche of everybody. And so it's great to recall the successes you guys had and the smiles you put on the faces of everybody in town as fans. And I'm sure the warmth it made on your insides to have your success. So.
Thanks for calling us today.
Yeah.
It's been fun.
Take care.